गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल
हेलो।
सर। यस सर, गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
हाँ
ओके सर।
ఇదే వచ్చింది సార్। హలో హలో హలో
సార్, గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్।
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్।
ఓకే సార్, ఓకే సార్, రైట్। Good morning. Thank you for being here this morning. Welcome to UGC sponsored 4-day webinar on impact of COVID-19 on educational sector in India and strategies to face the pandemic. Today we are pleased to welcome Dr. B. Ravikant, a resource person from SRKR Engineering College, Bhimavaram. Dr. B. Ravikant is associate professor ratified by JNTU Kakinada and in charge career development center. Sir completed MBA and MSc in psychology and PhD in psychology. Sir having 18 years experience. Sir responsibilities teaching and training in soft and life skills, psychological counseling, assessment and career guidance. Sir published 20 publications in different national and international journals and case studies. Sir delivered 28 guest sessions in various academic institutions on psychology and personality development. Sir is working with IGNO on design and development of certificate program in soft skills for police personnel, Ministry of Home Affairs, New Delhi. Sir published 20 articles on Indianness in www.revivalofindianism.blogspot.com. related to national heritage and cultural values. Today he will be sharing with us on psychological issues among students, faculty and parents due to pandemic. With that, I ask that you give your full attention to Dr. B. Ravikant and help me in welcoming him to webinar. Now I request Dr. B. Ravikant to take over the session. Thank you, sir.
Seminar. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir.
I'm very glad that you have given me a fine introduction, and it's a lovely opportunity for me to interact with all like-minded today on the occasion of national webinar. It's a 4-day UGC sponsored national webinar that ABN College Autonomous Vijayawada is organizing. The theme of the webinar is the impact of COVID-19 on education sector in India and strategies to face the pandemic. And today I am going to deal on psychological issues or interventions for coping with COVID. So it's a pleasure for me to interact with all of you, and hope I can justify my invitation to bring out the best of my thoughts on psychological interventions and coping strategies. And the first things first, I owe my gratitude to KBN College management and special appreciation to IQAC team for organizing this event. And it's very difficult to what is this called as organize these kind of events virtually, because the context is entirely different, and to bring the right resource person to the platform requires a lot of efforts. And I really appreciate IQAC team as well as the principal of KBN College as well as the management for taking wonderful opportunity to bring out this webinar. I also thank UGC for encouraging education institutions to come out with these kind of virtual webinars, because the context is very, very complex, and it requires a lot of intellectual thought process to bring out novel ideas or important facts or research-oriented deliberations that require all of us to come together and then address the problem of COVID-19 in India. So I'm very thankful to UGC, and I'm also indebted to my teachers, without whom I would not be present here in this particular position. So I'm very thankful, and my prayers to my gurus as well as teachers. So these are the key learning objectives. My request to all of you is that I am one among you. Don't think that the resource person is different from the audience. The resource person is part of the audience. We are all part of the learning community. We are all teachers at the end of the day. And so don't think that I am different from you. In fact, I am very happy to share with you that I am part of you. I came representing you to this particular platform to share our collective opinions to the world, the teaching community, to parents community, to the students community. So here today, we are all together trying to understand about the pandemic and its impact on education sector, and in what way it is going to influence the parents, in what way it is going to influence the students as well as the teaching community, and how this particular pandemic is going to have an impact on future education. So that is the reason the key learning objectives for all of us to discuss are as follows. We are going to understand the effect of COVID on education sector. So here I'm going to bring out the facts that we have observed since last 1 month or so. I'm also going to introduce Vedic psychology for integrated education, because if we have to learn about to deal with the future, we cannot basically cut ourselves from the past, because we have to know some of the finest facts that in the past there are many incidents that have happened, and we should know from the past how they are able to deal with the complexities of life and living, and how they have addressed the problems. From the experiences of past, we can try to understand how we can deal with these kind of complexities in the present, and how we can plan ourselves to the future. So that is the reason I'm trying to bring Vedic psychology. So we need not basically think that Vedic psychology is all related to rituals, but as a matter of fact, there is a lot of science that is hidden in that, and I'm going to bring out the proven science of psychology during Vedic times, and how people have tried to learn and then try to resolve many of the complexities that have arisen during past. And I'm also going to bring research findings on social and behavioral issues during crisis situations, because this is very, very important. Without understanding the what is this called as research, research, we cannot basically come up with our own opinions or prejudices. Because if we try to give our own opinions, then it will not lead to any kind of genuine work to solve an issue. So we require some kind of evidence-based research that will be helpful for all of us in order to cope with the complexities of COVID-19. So I'm going to bring those research findings from social and behavioral sciences. And after that, I'm going to discuss about challenges of online training, online teaching and learning. There are a lot of challenges from the student's point of view, from the teacher's point of view, from the parent's point of view, as well as from the institution point of view also. So I'm going to talk about it. And I will also discuss about coping strategies also. What are the best coping strategies from behavioral sciences as well as from philosophy, and how we can come back to our normalcy. And finally, the question and answer session follows. So there are a lot of slides, almost 20-25 slides are there, and I'll plan in such a way that I'm going to deal with all the slides as effective as possible. So my request to all of you is to go through the presentation attentively, because there are a lot of insights that we all together can share. So before I start, let me try to give you about what was actually discussed earlier by Professor Ram Mohan Ragal. He's a seasoned person, and he has a lot of experience in academic institution. He served in various positions, and I'm sure that I'm sorry, there is a small issue. Is my voice audible?
Sir, you are audible.
Hello.
No problem,
yes,
sir.
Yeah. I'm very, very thankful. Today, let me try to basically bring out what Professor K. Ram Mohan Ragaru has given some important insights to all of us, because I'm not going to speak something different from what the previous resource persons have discussed. I'm going to extend whatever thoughts they have actually shared with all of us. So Professor Ram Mohan Ragaru has said that this is a best opportunity for self-learning. We never had any kind of previous opportunities for self-learning, and this pandemic impact has created a very good opportunity for all of us to have this kind of self-learning opportunity. And he also mentioned about competencies of teaching faculty. Now because of this pandemic impact, the teaching competencies have to be changed or adapted to the teaching methodologies that we are going to initiate to the students' community. Earlier, the teachers interacted very freely in the classroom, so there is a lot of autonomy for the teacher to interact freely. So they have their own tried and tested teaching style, and they are in control of it. Now, the teaching methodology should be changed, because they have to go for this virtual training, and there are a lot of challenges when a teacher comes in front of the computer without knowing who the audience is all about. So the teaching competencies have to change, the teaching methodologies have to change to suit to the current requirements. That is what he has actually pointed out. And there is a myth that temporarily we have to adapt to this virtual learning. People say that this virtual learning will basically end as soon as coronavirus is eliminated from the environment. But I don't really agree with this particular statement that temporarily we have to adapt to this virtual learning. As a matter of fact, I'm not talking about this virtual learning, but it is very important for each one of us to have this independent learning by ourselves. We have to make it as a habit throughout our life. It is a continuous learning that we should not depend on others, but we are supposed to depend on ourselves and the resources that are available. And then we are supposed to see that how we can basically utilize the environment to learn things that are absolutely related for our personal development as well as for career development. So we cannot say that temporarily we are going to learn everything online, but as a matter of fact, learning is a continuous process of realizing one's own ignorance. So we should basically take responsibility of learning independently all the times. And Professor Ramamohan Rao garu also mentioned about objectives of education. He said that the knowledge has to be disseminated, the knowledge has to be created, training on learning skills, developing creative thinking, behavioral shaping. In fact, when he mentioned behavioral shaping, it is very difficult to shape the behaviors or to train the behaviors virtually, because virtually, predominantly through online education, in most of the cases, you are transferring the data or information to the learner. So if at all he has to basically change his behaviors, for example, his sensitivity or his sensitiveness or his risk-taking abilities or tolerance or manners or virtues, you know, these are some of the core personality traits an individual has, and it is very difficult for a learner to basically learn by himself these traits. So I'm not saying that, you know, he cannot learn independently, but as a matter of fact, he has to know how he has to learn those virtues or traits independently, because we never taught the student to know how to learn. So this is a major issue that students will have to basically fight learning how to learn. So this was not taught since school days. So that is the reason this is going to be the biggest challenge for all of us. So this is what Professor Ramamohan Rao garu has dealt with. And today I'm going to discuss something that is related to psychological perspectives of looking at this pandemic. Now I'll move to the next slide. The next slide will actually take you through how I'm going to introduce this webinar to all of you. So if you can go through this particular slide, I'm going to introduce the participants with facts, because there is a lot of fake news that is predominant in the market. And if at all we go by fake news, then we are not only putting ourselves at risk, but we are also basically spreading the risk along with us to others. Because the problem is, we already have a virus in the environment. We do not know how to deal with it. Now, let us not add more problems to the existing virus in the form of rumors, in the form of fake news, in the form of conspiracies that we all are witnessing through social media. So it is knowledgeable for us. It takes a lot of professionalism for us to know what exactly is a fact, to know what the truth is all about. Let us not react to the situations outside. Let us try to respond to the situations outside. So that is the reason I'm going to introduce the participant with facts. And I'm going to take a virtual tour to all of you to ancient system of integral education. I already mentioned that. So what our ancient model of education system was, how the disciples have learned the basic and core issues of personality and outer learning in order to get on to their activities. And after that, I'm going to talk about the existing literature about the problem. So what does the research in behavioral sciences tell us, and in what way the research helps us to basically face the COVID-19 challenge? And yes, there is an online survey that I'm going to conduct maybe at 11:30. That will basically give you a small kind of indication about your personality and how you are supposed to respond to the pandemic or COVID-19 by understanding your personality. So this is what I'm going to do at 11:30. So I hope to complete most of the theory part before 11:30 so that I can administer that online survey. And finally, I'm going to offer some coping strategies to individuals and institutions to make informed decisions. My dear participants, today we all have gathered in order not to just share, you know, the thoughts from the speaker to the learned audience or from the learned audience to the speaker, but as a matter of fact, together we are all coming together in order to highlight the challenges and see that these challenges are heard by the concerned people at the institution level, at the family level, at a student level, as well as at an organization level, because we are all participating together, we are all coming together in order to address our issues. In fact, I am very happy that this webinar contains participants from all the important stakeholders. Like, we have students participating in this webinar, we have parents participating in the webinar, we have teachers also participating in the webinars, and I'm confident that the management is also participating in this webinar, which means that if this webinar is only isolated or restricted only to the students, and I need to basically speak either for the students or against the students. So if I'm speaking in favor of students, then the students may throw the blame on the teaching community or administration or parents, and they will basically rub their hands and they will feel complacent. So it is not like that. So we are all together here to know our responsibilities and then to raise our voice through this particular webinar and inform the concerned people in the society about the challenges that needs to be addressed through this particular insights from this webinar. So finally, this webinar will basically end with the Q&As. I'm not saying that by the end of the webinar, I'm going to address Q&As, but as and when you feel an important question has to be asked because of my presentation notes, you can always give your inputs in terms of giving your insights or asking some questions, so that we will try to answer it appropriately to the needs of the audience. So this is about the webinar methodology. And now, as the methodology says, the first part of presentation is all about facts. So whether you like it or dislike it, we are supposed to start from the scratch to understand what exactly is this COVID-19 all about. The more the number of times we know about it very clearly, the better we can basically plan to prepare to deal with it. So that is the reason. Let us go back in one or two slides and understand what exactly is this COVID-19. As we all know, this COVID-19, coronavirus disease, is an infectious disease caused by newly discovered coronavirus. Now, when we say discover, let us not basically come out with some kind of vague meanings or try to blame on some countries about the invention of the virus or the discovery of virus in some part of the world. This exactly is not our problem. Our problem is to basically know how we can deal with this at this particular point of time. So let us not worry about who has spread it and what are the consequences. As I said to you earlier, that already there is a problem in the environment. Let us not add more problems to the environment. Most people affected with COVID-19 virus will experience mild to moderate respiratory illness and recover without requiring special treatment. The good news for all of us is that from WHO, World Health Organization statistics, as well as from the Indian Medical Association, we are coming to a very good understanding that the rate of people dying because of this coronavirus is not at an alarming rate. So there are a lot of people who are actually recovering from this coronavirus. So, and I'm very happy, and it is a good news for all of us that it all requires very good preparation of our mind in order to deal with this coronavirus. As a matter of fact, you pretty well know there are a lot of patients suffering from cancer because of their boldness, because of their understanding of what exactly the cancer is all about. They are able to beat the cancer and then they are able to come back to normalcy. So there are a lot of live examples like that, and corona is an infectious disease. We are supposed to take some kind of precautions, and that is sufficient for us to basically come back to normalcy. And there are older people in the society, with some kind of underlying medical problems like cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, chronic respiratory diseases. the news is that, you know, they are the people who are more vulnerable to COVID-19. So we are supposed to, you know, foster a wonderful environment, positive environment in the homes, so that the elderly people, you know, because of the positivity in the home, you know, will feel some kind of solace, because, you know, they are already having some kind of anxiety levels, that they are elderly people and they have some kind of underlying medical problems. Let us not, you know, change our body language and then be suspicious about elderly people in the homes, because that will put them under more pressure. So let us try to be cheerful in the home, and let us try to be more positive in the home, so that the elderly people, when they look at our body language, will feel more comfort because of our reaction in the family. So this is an important insight that I would like to share with all of you. And the best way to prevent and slow down transmission is to be well informed about COVID-19 virus. This is very important. You know, as we all pretty well know, that WHO till date has not officially announced any kind of vaccination. There are a lot of trials that are happening in medical centers, medical research centers in India as well as in the world. People are actually really burning their time in order to come out with a solution for this. So let our prayers be with them, so that, you know, they can come out with a very good vaccination. And because we cannot deal with coronavirus medically with a vaccination, because it is not yet there in the market, so we can basically prevent coronavirus from distributing in the market. So what is that we can do? So the first advice that WHO has given to us is social distancing or physical distancing. When I'm using this word social distancing, there is again a big cry in the market by some people, some sections of the people, that we should not use social distancing because it is trying to differentiate between one class to another class in the society. That let us not basically look into that particular word microscopically and then try to aggravate the situation or try to deviate the situation to a different problem. The intention of saying social is in society, there are a lot of people who are actually moving. So there is a need for us to maintain distance. Yes, technically it is physical distance, but nevertheless, the intention is not to basically have a difference between classes. So that is the reason when we say social distancing, let us not basically misunderstand the word, but understand the intention, that it is all about respecting each other's privacy, the distance privacy, and see that because of us, the other person is not affected. If at all we have that particular attitude in our mind, then obviously the other person will basically feel in the same way as we are actually feeling. So that is one important measure of prevention that we can practice. And the other aspect of COVID is why we are supposed to go for this social distancing, at least for 6 feet. People say it is for 4 feet, but it is all advisable for us to basically be at a 6 feet distance, because the droplets of saliva or discharge from the nose when somebody sneezes or somebody coughs, can travel till 6 feet. So this is what WHO has suggested, to have at least 6 feet distance. So there are occasions where we are supposed to be in proximity with some people. So to an extent, we have to avoid them, or we are supposed to have the protective gear with all of us to see that nothing goes wrong. So this is another important aspect that we are supposed to take care of. And before I start the presentation with a small case, I would like to basically bring a small psychological concept to all of you. There are a lot of people who know about this concept called as OCD. It is called as obsessive compulsory disorder. When I mean obsessive compulsory disorder, some people generally try to do an activity repeatedly that either disturbs them or disturbs people around them. So when we say OCD, so it is actually, you know, what is this called? Not a healthy sign for an individual. So there are people with, you know, an OCD complaint saying that, that, you know, they wash their hands very frequently, or they bath at least thrice whenever they enter into a bathroom. So, you know, so that was a problem for them as OCD affecting them. But now this OCD is a good news for those kind of people because, you know, in a way they are actually trying to keep their health to be very, very conscious. I'm not saying that by trying to be more preventive in our nature, let us not basically develop the cleanliness as a compulsive habit for all of us, without which the life will be void. So let us not think in those lines. So this is a situation where we are supposed to be very, very preventive in nature. So let us try to be appropriate to the conditions right now. Over a period of time, when vaccination comes, and then when we are when everything is normal, then, you know, we can come back to our normalcy. And let us not try to basically be compulsive in our what is this called as making ourselves to be very, very clean. So otherwise it becomes a habit, and then it becomes another OCD kind of activity, and then to come out from that particular OCD will again be a problem. So the conclusion is, you know, we have to know what we are doing and why we are doing it. So if we have those particular thoughts in our mind that we are doing this because if we don't do this, you know, the consequences are going to be undesirable. So that is the reason I am doing this particular activity. It is always healthy. So later, if at all things are fine, then there are no issues for all of us. Things will be normal, and then we can come back to our normalcy. So with this, let us try to enter into the impact of COVID on education sector. I will start with a small case because the case is very, very light. Most of you, know about this particular case. And from this case, we will try to learn about the basic concepts of COVID-19 having its impact on education sector. The case is like this. Sandhya, a class 7 student in Vijayawada, Andhra Pradesh, last attended school on March 16. So since then, she has been learning via computer and mobile phone ever since. The notes and assignments would be posted online. She is encouraged to chat with her teachers to clarify doubts. So this is what we have observed since last couple of months. People are hooked to internet, and from morning 9 to afternoon 12 or 1. So there are a lot of people, a lot of teachers who are actually working behind the computers to come out with very good methodologies to engage the students between 9 to 1. So now this particular student called Sandhya, who is studying 7th standard, she never experienced from LKG till 7th standard to learn online. She was not taught why she has to learn online, as a matter of fact. So now she is she's put in a position where she has to hook herself to the internet, and then she has to learn through online. So is it a right situation for Sandhya to react positively to the situation? Can we try to basically convince Sandhya that everything is going to be fine? So what is Sandhya's opinion on this? So she says that I prefer to be in classroom. Every other thing I am virtually doing is boring, because she never had a previous experience to basically have a, you know, independent learning environment to, you know, by herself. So all of a sudden, because she is not connected with her friends, because there is no live classroom environment in front of her, you know, things are not so comfortable to her. And this is a feedback that we can expect from Sandhya. Now, we have to know the fact that Sandhya is among 1.26 billion children worldwide, as UNESCO says, who are affected by school closures due to pandemic. In fact, you'll be surprised to know This is 72% of world's student population. India comprises over 320 million of these learners. This is a big statistic that we have in front of us. There are a lot of students like Sandhya who are actually being challenged with this particular situation. They are being affected. They are not trying to be natural to themselves, and they are supposed to adapt forcibly to the kind of conditions the situation is asking them for. So because of this online learning, there is a drastic increase in online tools. There are a lot of websites which have started designing online tools, and many students across the world are actually downloading these online tools like language apps, virtual tutoring, Zoom, WhatsApp, Skype, Meet, and other online tools. But as a matter of fact, the truth is nothing is able to compensate for the absence of classroom experience, because we need life. We want to feel the life around us, then only we'll be so comfortable. We do not want all the materials around us or the electronic gadgets around us for us to be comfortable. So something inside generally pulls us towards life, towards people, towards affection, towards love, towards caring. So that is the reason the present situation is not so comfortable to learn. But as a matter of fact, we are supposed to accept the route and then go accordingly. So now, what are the possibilities that this COVID-19 has on education sector? So I'm going to give you three possibilities of COVID-19 on the society. There are three possibilities that generally seems to happen. The first possibility is that COVID is eliminated by vaccination. There is no COVID in the society. So earlier we have smallpox. That smallpox was actually eliminated by developing a vaccination, and so nobody is actually fearing for smallpox. In the same way, one of the possibilities is that COVID-19 is eliminated by vaccine. Now, is this possibility right now we are experiencing it? Absolutely not. As I said to you earlier, WHO did not announce any kind of vaccine officially. So the first possibility is out of our discussion. And let us not basically think negatively about the future outcomes. Let us try to be optimistic. Man is always optimistic. He has to basically go forward, meet the life very enthusiastically, not think about what has happened earlier. So that is the reason. Let us try to be very, very optimistic about what is going to happen in the future. Now, the third possibility is the full impact. Now, that means that the government has failed, or the public has failed in order to prevent the COVID in society. So people started moving here and there. They are not at all responsible. Even though they have some kind of symptoms of COVID or any kind of infection, they are not disclosing it, and they started to move freely here and there. So this is an issue. So if public do not take responsibility, then governments will fail. There may be a lot of mechanisms that government can opt for. If government opts a very, very, unhealthy mechanism, that is going to basically put us in the most undesirable situation. So let us not hope a situation where government basically imposes a strict curfew that people are not allowed outside. So there is partial lockdown that we are supposed to appreciate. We are supposed to cooperate with the government. There are shops or merchandise establishments that are open for us, and we have to know how we can approach them by taking necessary steps, not by coming out openly and then trying to disturb ourselves as well as disturb others also. So that is the reason I'm representing all of you to say that let us try to be very, very responsible when we are actually there in this lockdown 5.0. So this is the third possibility. The second possibility is what we are actually facing or we are experiencing. So slowly, the government is actually coming out with a lot of what the convenient measures for public to basically feel comfortable in the market. But as a matter of fact, I said to you that the responsibility is not on the government. We should not blame the government for the what is called as the increase in COVID, but it is the responsibility of public to be more understandable, more knowledgeable, to know how we can prevent this particular COVID from affecting others. So this is very, very important for us to understand. Now, if let us come to this particular important point, where if COVID is going to stay with us for some time, and we have partial lockdown that is happening, and government is not so comfortable in allowing academic institutions to open. So because, you know, because a classroom contains 60 to 70 students in higher education, whereas it is slightly less in secondary education. But as a matter of fact, when you come down from higher education to lower levels of academics, we pretty well know that the children may not basically have that kind of attitude to protect themselves or to organize themselves to prevent the COVID infection. So it is very difficult for children to basically be proactive to for preventive measures. So government is very, very careful when it comes to academic institutions opening their gates for regular academic sessions. So they are very, very cautious. So if this particular situation continues, then what does it indicate to all of us? Now, there are a lot of permutations and combinations for this. If this COVID continues, will academic institutions start to plan for online classes? Not for a certain period of time, but will they basically think of substituting a teacher with an online technology? This is going to be a big situation, catch-22 situation for the academic institutions and for the teaching community. So what is going to happen? What is their plans? This is very, very important. Now I'll tell you, I will not basically go into the motives of academic institutions, whether they will basically go for online classes or invest in infrastructure or technology and substitute a teacher with technology, but I'm not going to go about it right now. But I'm going to focus on the absence of a teacher in the classroom vis-a-vis a student learning online. That is what my focus is all about. Now, what kind of students we are planning to design, if at all we are planning for online classes? So are we trying to design a student who can fit the family environment through online classes? Can we best design a student for the industry, the society, as well as for the country? In among these four variables, the best variable that online classes can basically suffice is the industry. The industry is very much interested to take a student who has the necessary skills to do a particular job. So most of the technological aspects of learning can happen through what is called as online portals. So that can happen, but is it sufficient to produce a student only for the sake of industry and leave the student to his destiny or inappropriate to family environment, to the society and country? So if at all we have to take a decision about online classes, then there is a big challenge for all of us to know whether we are training the student to be a part of a very good family environment or to basically work for a wonderful family environment, to be a responsible person in the society, as well as to be a very good citizen to the country. So this has to be understood by all of us. Now, I would like to bring some important aspects as to why a student has to basically attend a college live physically. Now, I have my own thoughts here, my dear learned audience, that a student, when he enters into a college, forget about what he is learning in the classroom. Let us not basically think about whether the student is able to learn anything from the teacher, from the textbooks, from the lectures, from the labs. Forget about the knowledge part or the intellectual part of learning. But if a student enters into a college, a physical atmosphere of a college, then what are things that he is exposed to? This is what I would like to share with all of you. You know, that these are the slides that I have presented to you to show you that there are very good aspects of a college. So all these images can also be part of your college also. A gate is there for a student to enter, and you have a big, what is this called as a lifetime image of the founder, which is garlanded, and we have trees, the flora that is spread over the campus. We have students eating together in the campus. We have hostel facilities where a group of students share the room to learn and then to share their the problems. And we have a playground where students can basically play, and we have cultural shows, and we have eminent personalities who generally visit our campus to share their experiences. So these are the images that are there that I have provided to you. If a student enters into a campus and observe these, that itself is actually sufficient for the student to gain a lot of insights. As a matter of fact, I try to enlarge this particular slide so that you will know that there is stimulus to my left side and learning to the right side. I am not talking about what he is going to learn from the textbooks, but you know, if you observe the stimulus called as watchman, you know, he is deeply interested in our identity. He checks our identity every day. So that is what his duty is all about. When a student looks at the founder's image, then he can basically know or understand the struggles the founder had in his lifetime and why he thought of establishing a wonderful education institution in order to achieve his vision. So you can find a lot of buildings. I know there are a lot of education institutions spread across the country, which have started in the early 1980s. So there is a lot of history behind these buildings. I know some of the colleges where the first generation, what is this called as thatch roofs or the sheds that was originally there at that point of time, constructed at the point of time, were preserved to be in the same order because they are very, very sentimental in nature, that they want to preserve that particular antique model of classroom that was initiated when the college was established, to show to the next generation students how the classroom happened in this kind of settings. So there is a lot of heritage about the buildings that a student can get exposed to. And you'll also find a lot of quotations or quotation placed everywhere in the classrooms or corridors or in the streets of the campus, as well as photographs of great personalities. You know, we pretty well know that a word or a sentence or an image can change the outlook of a student. You pretty well know during freedom struggle, the one word that has brought a lot of enthusiasm or fighting spirit among all Indians is Vande Mataram. That word has given a lot of energy to those freedom fighters who felt that, yes, it is necessary for us to respect our motherland and to protect our motherland from foreign invasion. So that Vande Mataram, and after that Subhash Chandra Bose, Jai Hind, you know, these are some of the words which will capture the attention of people. Some word can capture the attention of some student at some point of time. A sentence, an image, we do not know. Anything can affect an individual at any point of time. All it requires is that particular point of time where a student observes the word, and the word or a sentence or an image directly enters into his thought process, deeper levels of thought process. And from there, you know, you can understand how he will react to the situations. The trees, you pretty well know that it is a selfless evolution. you know, a tree can, the best output of a tree is to basically come out with a fruit. And that is the reason it has evolved in a large space. You know, sometimes there may be no fruits, but you know, the leaves are very, very essential. And sometimes the branches are very essential for some people for cooking. And sometimes it is necessary for a bird to lay its nest on the tree. So if at all we go on, these are some of the subtle issues which we know, but they can capture the attention of people who are actually looking at them very seriously. And there are, I'm not talking about the medicinal properties that are always there in every tree. We have to discover about the medicinal properties. We have canteen where people generally share the food. The togetherness is actually felt. We have some stationary shops in the campus, which will basically make an individual understand that along you know, with this institution, there are few families which are dependent on this institution. So every amount that I basically you know, invest outside, you know, a family is supported with the basic necessities of life. So that is also understood. We have teachers who are somebody for, you know, students working for building their careers. So we have iron mask cleaning, all that we have left stupid and unnecessary. We have cultural programs and spirits which will kindle the fun or creativity and team spirit in us. We have hostels, which gives us a very good experience about adjustment, sacrifices, support, and touching life stories. We have classrooms where, even though I'm not interested, a student may not be interested to be in the class, but in a very good student can be a part of this particular disinterested student and still you know, motivate the disinterested student to be a part of the class. Maybe at some point of time, the disinterested student can be you know, kindled and then motivated to the class. So it all is a this is a wonderful environment where you know, the support of the peer group will influence the student's motivation to learn. And the last, not but the least, esteemed visitors, life lessons of great personalities. We can understand from them what their life experiences are. For example, it is very difficult for a seasoned person, a scientist, at the age of 60 years, coming to our campus, talking to us in 1 hour about the most important aspects of life. So whatever body he utters, it means it is absolutely refined through him. It has undergone a lot of he has undergone a lot of process in different layers, processed in different layers, and it is coming out from his mouth out in such a way that each and every word means a lot to the students. So as you all know, as you all agree, that without anything from the class, we can basically, a student can basically get inspired or motivated by his physical presence in the class. So this is a brief introduction about why a student has to basically come to the class physically. That is what I started to introduce to you. And I would like to give you a small kind of my personal experience about the way I look the teacher as. This is purely my personal opinion, and it can be debated, and I'm sure most of you will also agree. I believe that a teacher, when he enters in the classroom, he is or she is very, very autonomous. And teaching is the only profession where we can design whatever we want. When I say whatever we want, I assume that the teacher understands the noble philosophy of teaching profession and the needs of the students. So when this particular assumption is very strongly rooted in a teacher, he will basically teach something to the student, whatever he wants. So for example, I may prepare something to the class today about thermodynamics, or I might have prepared something about international management or international marketing or international human resource management to the class. But when I'm coming from my staff room to the class, I might have experienced or seen something while I'm coming to the class, or they might have, there is some incident that has happened in the morning time in the college, either with a student or with a teacher, or in the society, there might be an incident that has happened in the society. And background of this particular class, students are aware of those situations that have happened. So when I enter into the classroom, there is no need for me to basically start the subject directly. I can introduce the topic about the experience that I had experienced before coming to the class. Or there may be a situation that has happened in the society. Or there is a news, big news in the society about some event. For example, Disha's event. Somebody has, some sections of the society have raped Disha, and that is a buzzword in the media. So the media is trying to bring out all the information in order to increase their PRP ratings. But if I try to be responsible to the things that are happening, I may basically stop or postpone the topic that I am supposed to say from the subject, but I can basically bring the topic that is very, very relevant for the students to know what is happening in the society, how it has to be analyzed. If I try to bring that particular situation to the classroom and make the students understand what exactly is the problem, how it has to be understood, how it has to be analyzed, and if there is any news about it, how do we distinguish between the real news and the fake news? And if somebody is talking about it, in what way we can basically resist the temptation to go for an argument? Or how can we basically educate the people who are actually talking something wrong about the topic? All these things can be possible by a teacher when he or she enters the session. So in that way, a teacher is not just trying to be a mechanical, what is this called as, orator of the subject, but a teacher is also playing an important role of making the student to know about the things that are happening in the society. So I feel, finally, that the last thing a teacher can do is to deliver the subject. I am sure most of the management people may not agree with me, because the syllabus completion or the syllabus coverage is very, very important for the administration. But as a matter of fact, I believe that the best teacher is the person who will not complete the syllabus, but as a matter of fact, will try to impress upon the student an inspiration towards the subject. He may deal with the subject in a very well manner, but more than completion of the syllabus, if the student is directed if the student is able to generate some kind of curiosity to learn about the subject, that is the completion of a very good teacher. Because the student is able to learn by himself rather than dependent on the teaching notes or the teacher in the classroom. So once the teaching is over, the student, because of the inspiration about the subject from the teacher, he can interact with the teacher offline. So unfortunately, in the current online settings, that offline interaction is the biggest handicap or a casualty in offline learning. I'm sure when there are 60 students in the classroom, the disadvantage is that no student may raise his hand or stand up in the classroom and then express their doubts very, very freely, because he or she is exposed to a lot of criticisms or comments from their peer group. So because of that reason, the student might not be interested in the class, raising a question in the class, but the student can come to the teacher when the teacher is there in the staff room and discuss about the subject, because the student has been inspired, not because of the subject, but a motivation towards the subject has been kindled in the student. So that is the reason I know that there are a lot of learned teachers who are actually listening to me. I'm trying to reinforce the existing motivation they have to be an inspirational teacher. And many of them are really inspirational teachers. And I am hopeful that more than the subject to be delivered, what is important for them, for the teachers, is to basically spread the motivation levels about the subject of the student in order to increase the independent learning. So from there, the independent learning is possible, rather than basically initiate independent learning just because of some catastrophe in the market. So a student should basically desire for independent learning, and then the online tools will basically enable a student to learn more, rather than forcing a student to learn through online tools about something which he is not motivated. You know, it is going to be a very big problem for the student. So there should be an evolution in the student to learn independently. So that can be kindled, or that can be motivated by a teacher. That is only possible when a teacher is in front of him live, and because of different methodologies that the teacher can adapt, that different ways the teacher can basically motivate a student in the classroom about different aspects of life. So a student can basically bring out his motivation levels to undergo this independent learning. Now I know that I'm actually going at a pace which might seem uncomfortable to all of you, but this is a fact that we are supposed to understand some basic concepts in this particular manner. So I hope and apologize for any inconvenience caused to you in my flow of communication. So let me try to draw your attention to Vedantic psychology and integral education. I'm sure you will know from the past how they have dealt with the education system, because as you pretty well know that if at all we are asking a student to learn through online, we know the fact that many of the students will enter into online education because they are forced to enter into online classes. You know, there is no motivation for a student to learn through online classes. So that is what an ordinary student may feel. So what makes an individual to learn by himself? So how is he trained? So let us go back to our ancient times to understand how this particular learning has happened, and how an integral personality was formed or shaped by the teachers. Now, during what is this called as Vedantic times or ancient times, you know, there are two kinds of learning. One is the inner learning, and second one is the outer learning. So the outer learning during those times is basing on the work, the people generally are supposed to do. So the outer learning is an activity-based learning, whereas inner learning is forming an important character insight that enables an outer learning. So let's see some of the outer learning aspects like Vedas, Vedangas, philosophy, art of debate, Itihasa, Dharma Sutras like laws, military, arts, etc. And you have botany and geology, which is actually taught during those days. It was quite early in this from the schooling, because you know the students of ancient times have to be introduced to this botany, because at that point of time the system has run because of agricultural facilities. Through agricultural fields, you know, people used to sustain, so they need to know the chemistry or botany of a plant, so that you know they can plant some of the important seeds, so that they will understand the medicinal properties as well as the food properties for them to basically live in a healthy manner. And the geology is also basically taught to the students, because they should also basically live along with some animals for milk products. That is very, very essential. So that is the reason a study on plants as well as animals is an important element for outer learning during ancient times. And Ayurveda was predominant at that point of time. So now, in order for the outer learning to form, the teachers during ancient ancient days focused on this inner learning. Now, what is this inner learning all about? Today, we are actually talking about soft skills. We are talking about life skills. In most of the engineering colleges, we find soft skills. But if at all we try to understand why soft skills have been positioned in an engineering college, we will come to some important conclusions that this soft skills is not basically to mold the personality for an individual to be a responsible citizen in the country, but as a matter of fact, the important needs of the students have to be achieved by him. So what are the important needs the student has to achieve? He's a job. So the students are basically tuned in order to basically have those skills that are necessary for him to get a job. Now, this is an important question. This is an important point where we can debate. Should we need to basically teach a student how to behave in an interview? Should we need to tell him how to talk, how to sit, how to walk, and how to answer a question, how not to answer a question? So is this an appropriate way of informing a student that, this is what you are supposed to speak, this is what you are not supposed to speak? Can't the student know that, by speaking like this only I'll basically get a job? Can't he know by himself? There are a lot of examples in and around him how this is not the first time that a student is getting a job in a multinational company. There are a lot of people before him who got into jobs. So he can learn from his peer group or from his seniors about how to basically get a job. So getting a job information is absolutely available in the market, in the internet. It is very easy. What are the frequently asked questions in C? What are the frequently asked questions in C++? What is this aptitude all about? What is this quantitative reasoning? So what is the soft skills all about? So what are these HR questions? All this information as knowledge is there in the internet. But is it necessary for a teacher to teach these aspects to his student? So I doubt about the way soft skills is being asked to be delivered. It is not that a soft skills teacher wants to deliver this like this, but unfortunately, because of the context, because of the demands, because of the conditions, soft skills trainers are actually asked to deliver, the content in such a way that the student will get a job. Now, student will get a job. Now, the problem is what will happen once he's there in the job? Because when we are talking about employability skills, there are three important skills in employability. One is ability to get a job. That means the skills that are necessary to get a job. What are the skills that are necessary to get a job? The student has to basically have knowledge or aptitude in English, vocabulary, quant, as well as coding and all that stuff. Or in other disciplines, it is their technical aspects knowledge should be there. And he has to face an interview. The interview is actually based on the resume or on the things that he has learned that is relevant to that particular job. Now, so one in employability skill, the first aspect is to basically develop the skills that are necessary for a job. But the problem is from the second aspect, the second skill in employability, the skills that are necessary to grow in the environment. We are actually bringing a company to the doorstep of the student, and he joins the organization because it is a fashionable job. So he will join the organization, and after that he is exposed to reality in the office environment. There are a lot of seniors in front of him. There are a lot of colleagues along with him. There are a lot of people who will come after him. So there are a lot of dynamics that are actually in the organization. There are politics, there are issues, there are biases, there are prejudices, there are stereotypes. So there are many things. Can the student cope with all these complexities in the organization? And can he basically grow in the organization? Are these things taught in the classroom? Or are we only focusing on to train those traits that are essential to get a job? So when we are actually talking about what is this called training a student, we should not only take the responsibility of training the student to get a job, we are supposed to also bring out some important aspects of complexities that are there in the organization that may hinder an employee to prosper or to basically move ahead in his job. So that is the growing the organization. So the second skill is the skills that are needed for a student to grow in the organization. Finally, the skills that are necessary for a student to basically retain the job. So, he should also know that over a period of time, whatever skills, he has may basically be void or not needed because of a new technology intervention in the industry. So he may have experience of mastering one particular technology for some time, but over a period of time, if the particular technology becomes obsolete or outdated, can we basically induce a motivation for this particular experienced person who has an obsolete knowledge to motivate him to learn a new technology? Will he have the motivation to learn a new technology? So the training or the learning that should basically get into his mind is not just to basically get a job, but the other aspects that will basically give him some kind of control when he's there in the society, in the industry. So that is the reason in the ancient times, in the Vedantic psychology, the inner learning is a matter of fact, was actually given a lot of importance too. So the inner learning contains these patients, how a guru taught patience to his disciples, regularity, dedication, self-denial, self-mastery, humility, concentration in pursuit of knowledge, purity of nature, study of yoga and yoga sutras. All these aspects are very important in order to form a character of a personality. In ancient education, it is very important for the teachers to basically construct a solid foundation for the outer learning to happen. It is like this, there is a seed and there is a soil. I'll give you an example. There is a seed and there is a soil. What is important? So what is important is, initially, the soil is more important than the seed. If the soil is not fertile, if the soil does not contain rich, nutrients, or if the soil is not conducive for a seed to basically grow, then if you bring an imported seed also to the soil, introduce the seed to this particular soil also, the seed may basically malfunction, or it will not basically sprout healthily. Now, if we say that, I brought this particular imported seed by investing a lot of money, but the issue is that, it did not grow. So that means, you have spent a lot of time and energy in bringing out an imported seed, but we have never bothered about building an environment where a seed can best be placed, and then the quality of the seed can be retained by the soil. So that is the reason, in most of the cases, we are supposed to basically build an environment where a student can basically learn the art of learning. Once he has mastered this art of learning, or once he has mastered all these issues that hinder him to learn, then any kind of learning that you place from outside, it can be related to biotechnology, it can be related to medicine, it can be related to anything, a student can absorb very easily. So that is the reason inner learning is very, very essential. As a matter of fact, the learning is complete only when the inner learning is complemented with outer learning. So you cannot basically be biased only on outer learning and then give less importance to inner learning. Generally, it happens in most of the colleges nowadays that the soft skills or the life skills, is actually given only for 1 hour in a week, and we expect very good citizens, socially responsible citizens in the country. So that is how things are happening in the market. So now we came to an understanding that this inner learning is as important as outer learning, and that is where ancient education has supremacy over the modern education system. So as you pretty well know, this kind of generation, the millennial generation, are lacking in patience. They are very, very sensitive also. So this patience is one of the most important qualities or traits that was actually taught by ancient teachers to their children, to their students, without which the student cannot basically have that particular endurance to learn for lifelong. So that is one important aspect. And Vedantic psychology also talked about some important aspects that are absolutely related to have an integral education. As we all know that there are five sheets in a personality. You can understand the five sheets as some kind of electromagnetic layers in us, fields in us. In fact, electromagnetic fields in us. The first field is Annamaya. The second field is pranamaya. The third one is manomaya, vijnanamaya, and anandamaya. Now, what are these? You know, there are a lot of learned audience in the listening to my session. They are aware of these kind of five sheets, and there are some people who may not basically are aware of these five sheets because this belongs to some particular religion. I apologize for bringing this particular example, but as a matter of fact, this is absolutely very, very what is this called as pure science. These sheets, you know, are basically starting from outer layers of a personality to the inner layers of personality, which means that in ancient education, you know, the system of education is in such a way that it is addressing different layers or levels of a personality, the physical level and an emotional level, the intellectual level, and then, you know, what is this called as the mental level. And then the last one is the spiritual level. So among these 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 sheets, the modern education is actually focusing on the manomaya purusha, or the reasoning, logic, argumentation, debate, and development of memory. So most of the education nowadays that is exposed to the students is based on the memory only. We are teaching the students to learn, and then basing on the memory, we are actually evaluating the students' personality and then giving them grades. So unfortunately, the other aspects like poetry and arts and the mastery over what is this called as physical personality are not basically taken care of. So a student has all these things inside him. As a matter of fact, we should not say that, you know, a student does not have these aspects inside him, but they should be discovered in an individual. You know, in Hinduism, we say that Aham Brahmasmi, that means I am Brahman, I am God. It is not out of arrogance that a person says like that, but as a matter of fact, it is the truth. From the divine, you know, this particular being has come. So there is no difference, as a matter of fact, from this being to the being that is called a super energy. So when a super energy, when from that super energy, if a being comes, then it is also carrying all the characteristics of that super energy, which means that I have everything. The only problem is that I have to discover all these aspects. So the education system should be in such a way where all these aspects have to be kindled during that education period where a student is, living to. So that is what I mean to say. And I'm also trying to bring out an important philosophy from Seneca, a Greek philosopher. This self-control, unfortunately, is missing in most of our young generation. So what Seneca has said, he's a Stoic philosopher. What he said is that in order to have self-control, so he said that, you know, we are supposed to identify some days during some periods, and then we are supposed to experience those days in such a way that we understand what exactly is hard living all about. So, you know, we are in a comfortable zone. I'm not saying that everybody is in comfortable zone, but as a matter of fact, most of the students are in comfortable zone. If there is any problem with respect to pandemic or COVID crisis, I can say very frankly that the problem is not much with a student. The fear is more with a parent who is actually working to get an income from some organization. That organization may be working, may not be working, so he has fear of basically losing the income. So there is a fear or an issue that a parent can face. There is a fear among old parents in the family where, you know, they are vulnerable to this COVID. You know, there is a fear among teachers about their employment. Whereas when it comes to a student, I assume that a student, a general student who does not have what is this called as any issues, need not fear for anything. As a matter of fact, he is supposed to basically know about his responsibilities during this particular pandemic. and focus on what he is supposed to do rather than unnecessarily fearing. So when a student unnecessarily fears, it is indicating that he has not planned for his future, or he is not planning for the present, and he is actually looking for a small kind of escape to basically move away from responsibilities. So what Seneca has said about self-control is, some days we are supposed to identify and then wear some kind of dress which might not be very, very comfortable to us. Because the more we are in comfort zone, the more we are not basically looking at realities of life. So earlier we thought that everything is fine. Now, unfortunately, all of a sudden, you cannot basically go very freely in the market. So you cannot basically sit with another person in a commutation, I mean to say in a transportation. So it is very difficult to basically adjust to these kind of situations. So it is always better, what Seneca has said is, to be in some kind of agitation or in kind of a situation where we know about the hardships of life. So by wearing a kind of dress or saying to yourself for a while, "This is the condition that I feared," we will know about the problems of others. So in that way, we can basically have some kind of self-control. Now, so what is the challenge that we can basically understand from last one and a half hour time? The challenge for all of us is, can online learning help students master inner learning, that is the basis for our learning? More specifically, can online learning help a student learn how to learn? This is an important question. Most of the people are actually exposed to learning, but unfortunately, they do not know how to learn and resist the temptations and desires hindering the learning. You know, when if I have to basically watch an important video that is actually given to me from my institution, from my college, so, you know, and if my mobile is ringing, or if my friend is asking me to basically interact via WhatsApp or Telegram, or if somebody is actually calling me to go outside, can I resist the temptations and desires and basically hook to or pay attention to what I'm supposed to do? So can this outer learning or the online class atmosphere, can that imbibe the inner learning or not? Can the online learning help a student discover the deeper layers of personality? This is, again, I said to you, the very system of education has basically kindled the different layers of education. The last one is the Anandamaya. Anandamaya, I did not mention over there. There is no information at that particular place because Anandamaya has to be is a stage where we are supposed to recognize or realize that we are Brahman. So that will take a lot of time, or it requires some kind of mastery of yogas to know that we are the supernatural energy. So that is actually the essence of religions, all the religions. So that is the reason. Does this particular modern education or online learnings will basically prevent a student to learn all the important aspects of learning and expose the student only to what is this called as a learning that is sufficient for him to get a job? So this is an important issue. That means in a person's mind, are we training a student only on the intellectual aspect and not on other aspects which are very, very significant for his happiness by the end of the day? So this is an important aspect that most of us are overlooking, or the system is overlooking it. So generally, if at all we look at a modern student who is in front of us, what are the stages of his growth that we are actually looking at him very naturally? So he has very limited interaction among his family members. So the respect towards family members is also limited. I'm not saying that everybody. There are students who are very, very good with their family members, and there is very good dynamics or interaction that happens in most of the family members. But there are also cases where most of the parents complain that their child or their son or daughter is having a limited interaction with them, and they are not following their suggestions. So a student without goal is entering into a fashionable education. This is, again, when I say fashionable education, you know, they are looking at people outside and then they are trying to basically build their careers or trying to copy them. So they are not able to understand their needs, or they are not looking at the needs of the society. So they are discounting the principle to ignore their needs, their fulfillments, their motives, or the needs of the society, and basically entering into this fashionable education. So this is again a problem that has to be addressed by the administration. And there is also a hero worship. Yeah, blindly people generally look at a hero and then basically you know, do whatever it is for the sake of the hero. So that is another problem that is prevalent in the society. And most of the students are also influenced by media and friends. So the media, you pretty well know, will always try to basically attract the sensory organs of the students. So that is the reason they know the art of attracting a student. So the media attracts the students, and the student is more vulnerable to those attractions, and he may lose his focus on the realities of life. So the next one is, the companies don't test the character and conduct, but focus on job skills. I'm not saying that all companies, you can quote unquote, all the companies are not like that, but there are some companies which are focusing only on the job related skills that needs to be tested in an engineering student, or some students that are related to their professions, the aptitude part, the English part, the coding part, and an appointment as late for the next 40 life years. May get a job in MNC and fly abroad for posh life. So once he got a job, he flies abroad because, you know, he believes that, you know, Europe is great, the atmosphere is great, people are great, and then he goes up. Now, in this particular pandemic situation, can anybody plan to travel out? You know, I'm sure that most of the people who had those assumptions that, you know, Europe is great, and Japan is great, and then US is great, Britain is great, New Zealand, Australia are great destinations for them to basically live their life. You know, now they are actually realizing that, you know, the happiness is to basically live in India in our own homes. So that kind of self-contentment or fulfillment, they have come. So that is how it's only a matter of assumption for people, that people over there are enjoying, over here things are not as I am looking comfortable. So that is the reason, let me go out over there. So finally, what happens is, I know all the students are growing vertically and they are dying horizontally. So they are growing like tall, what is this called as coconut trees, but they are not actually expanding the, what is this called as the stems or the branches or the leaves, by which many more number of people can also basically take shelter under them. So that particular tree, which is actually growing like a banyan tree, which is giving its, what is this called as, giving an opportunity for many people to basically risk underneath kind of education, is missing in the present modern Indian education. So that is only possible when we try to basically go back to our ancient system of education, bring out some of the important values, and try to basically train the students in the values that are necessary for our Indian culture and society. This is very important. Should we need to basically train our students for some foreign culture? So this is another issue. So that is where the problem is all about. So if a student is exposed only for online education, he will basically take online learning that is necessary for him to basically get a job, and then he will basically grow vertically. And finally, what is happening? So he may not become an inspiration for people over here. In India. So that is how the problem is all about. Is this life worth living? Is a big question. So now, research findings on social and behavioral issues during crisis situations will be dealt. Now the time is 11:30 sharp. So what we can do is, we can go for a small kind of survey along with a break. And once you come out, come back from the break, we will discuss about the survey results, as well as some of the research findings that I have I'm going to bring in front of you. So, yes, Bharti madam, are you with me? Hello? Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir. Hello.
Madam. Yes, madam. Now we can basically go for a break.
Okay, sir.
And then we can also give what is this called as the survey also.
Okay.
Survey ma'am. Form
okay,
also. So once okay, they come sir. Back from the break and survey, I can discuss about the results for them.
Okay, sir.
Okay, madam.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. What shall I do, madam? Shall I basically click on leave or something like that? Or
okay, sir. You can leave, sir. Okay, sir. Let us take a 10 minutes break.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
All the participants, right. All the participants must take the survey.
Can you voice input? Okay, okay. Bani, you have a message. You have a message. You have a message.
All the participants must take the survey.
Okay. Okay. Okay.